opportunity to hit the restart button. Help us in our lives restart where you want us to be. It's in Jesus' name that we pray. Amen.
Amen.
So, New Year's resolutions that we have, you know, it's a law that we have to start about that. Anyone can be, want to have bacon every day? Okay, because that's, I'm yet to fulfill that one for today yet, but there's still, you know, a couple more hours today. Like, anybody else have a fun, off-the-wall one that they don't mind sharing? You know, no one had anything fun or exciting? Actually, last year was guest at a different church, and I said that my New Year's resolution was to eat bacon every day. And two ladies came up to me and were very concerned about my health and said that that was not a good New Year's resolution. I said, I'm not sure there could be a better one. I did not eat bacon every day. I took at least 3 days off. So. I want to talk about building something today. How many people like to build things at home? Again, I'm not asking if you're good at it. How many do you like to? Okay, because for me, there is a large difference between being good at something and enjoying it. And this is why I play golf every once in a while. I'm terrible at it, but I enjoy it. But a couple years ago, we had a dog. And my wife and I had very different views on how to treat a dog. Okay? I think a dog can go outside for an extended period of time because they're dogs. Okay? My wife thinks, for instance, should be in the house and the air conditioning and you know everything like that. So we had to have a compromise because the dog kept making mistakes in the house. And when they make mistakes outside the house, I don't really care. But when I come home to a big pile of something, you know, this is not how you want to walk into your house after a day. So I built our dog a doghouse. Now again, I am not an engineer nor a contractor. So I said, I need to build a doghouse, and I need to do it simple. So my wife said, how do you do that? I said, it's going to be 4 feet by 8 feet. The reason being, that's a standard size of a sheet of plywood. Okay. No measuring. Everything was 4 feet and 8 feet. Okay. That way I didn't have to cut anything. I could just build it. And you know, when I build something, you know, if you build it right, you probably need like 2 or 3 nails or a couple of them. I was building, we had tapcons, we had it bolted together. By the end of the day, the 4 feet by 8 feet doghouse was that big, and it weighed about 6,000 pounds because I even put shingles that I had left over for a mission trip on the roof. So we fast forward to a couple years later, we had sold the house, we were moving to our current house in Boynton Beach, and we had done the walkthrough. And I tried, because we gave the dog, I tried to actually move the doghouse, but again, I am cheap by nature, so I didn't use the pressure treated lumber. I used just regular wood because it was a lot cheaper, and that lumber just soaked up every bit of water. So that doghouse that weighed 6,000 pounds, I think when I built it, weighed like 12,000 pounds. So we were getting a call the next day from the people, you forgot your doghouse. Remember the contract said as is? Good luck with that. They're like, we can't move it. I know. So my doghouse, you know, like, you at least have your dogs. I got my kids afraid of my dog. But that was my thing in building. And what I'm going to think about today for us, because it is a new opportunity. A lot of times we do have new things that we try to, you know, start with on New Year's Day. And some of us even make it to like Tuesday before we give up. Okay? But I want to talk about building of a wall. And we're starting off in the book of Nehemiah today. We're starting off in chapter 1, verses 4. It says, when I heard these things, I sat down and wept. For some days I mourned and fasted and prayed before God of heaven. Then I said, Lord, the God of heaven, the great and awesome God who keeps his covenant of love with those who love him and keep his commands, let your ear be attentive and your eyes open to hear the prayer your servant is praying. See what happened back in the time that the great wall in Jerusalem had been destroyed. And all the gates had been destroyed. And it was where Nehemiah's relatives were from. It's where his ancestors were born. And he was great hearted that this great wall had been broken. And God put it on his heart that he was going to be the one to fix it. Now, I know what happens in my house sometimes when I say to my wife, I'm going to the garage to get some tools. She gets this panic look on her face. And then I end up calling my friend Charles and say, hey, can you help me out? He goes, what'd you start that you can't finish yet? Maybe some of you have that. And so Nehemiah put on his heart that he was going to be the one that did this. So Nehemiah, if you don't know, was the king's cupbearer. So his job was to bring the beverages to the king. And before he gave it to the king, he got the great job of tasting it to make sure it wasn't poisoned. Okay, so think about your job for the day. I mean, if some of us have a bad day, you know, every once in a while, and you know, then there's me in line who, I would think you'd be taking the coffee going, all right, hey, is everyone still like you today? Because that'd be a question that'd be number one on the list. Does everyone still like you? Or more importantly, does anyone not like the pig? Because back in the day, there was only a couple ways to get rid of a pig. And poison was, unfortunately, one of those things. So his job every day was to walk in with the king and probably his first cup of coffee or whatever they drank back then. So Nehemiah comes in and has this kind of sad face on him. And read the scripture, the king asked him, so why does your face look so sad when you are not ill? Because maybe the king thought, maybe Nehemiah heard a rumor. Can you imagine being your cupbearer, the one who gives you morning coffee and taste right before you do comes in and kind of looks kind of perplexed, kind of sad? Because then they'll go, all right, you take a sip, then maybe I'll wait a couple minutes before I take a sip, so to speak, because you never know what's going to happen. I was very much afraid, but I said to the king, may the king live forever. Why should my face not look sad when the city where my ancestors are buried lies in ruins, and its gates have been destroyed by fire? The king said to me, what is it that you want? And I prayed to the God of heaven, and I answered the king. Ever been in that situation where someone goes, what's wrong? And says, what can I do to make it right? My first reaction is like, I was going to ask for this, but I'm going to go to here now, right? I mean, if somebody who's doing video or, you know, shallow like I am, there are times, you know, you get the audience of the king, the one who can do anything, what can I do to fix this? But Nehemiah being who he is, and we caught it right, says, then I prayed to God of heaven, and I answered the king, if it pleases the king, and if your servant has found favor in his sight, let them send me to the city of Judah, where my ancestors are buried, so that I can rebuild it. Now think about that for a second. I don't know what qualifications you need to be the cupbearer, but I would think that if your project was going to be to go out and rebuild a wall and a bunch of gates, you know, they estimate somewhere between 1.5 kilometers to 4 kilometers, depending on which where you read. That's a big project. Think about you know, a kilometer or a third of a mile. Bobhouse had me going. Okay, I'm honest. And I'm not gonna tell you that it took me 2.5 weeks to build that thing. I think I just did. But Nehemiah didn't have a degree in carpentry. He didn't have some grand experience building things that we know of. But yet he just simply said, God, you put this on my heart. I'm going to go. And that's the first question for us to think about today, that what is God put on our hearts that we're so worried about whether we have the right qualifications to do? Because if he can make the creation of the world, and he can make us, if he puts that vision in our hearts, why can't he just also give us the ability to do it? Amen. That whatever's going on, don't worry about the distractions, but worry about nothing, because God puts you in that spot for that job. And also, something to think about today is to know that there are times when things are going to come up and they're going to be distractions. There are times where things are going to happen that are going to take us off point. And we're not to be worried about that. We're just worried we're supposed to have a plan. The king and the queen said, how long will your journey take? When will you get back? It pleased the king to send them, so I set a time. If it pleases the king, may I have letters to the government so that they will provide me safe conduct until I arrive. And may I have a letter to the keeper of the royal park so that he will give me timber to make the beams for the gates. Back in the time that if you, you know, how many people can play Monopoly? Ever play Monopoly? It's a fun game. You know, my boys play. They play the entire ride from West Palm to Marathon Friday afternoon. And I kept hearing, almost got Park Place, because they figured that if you get Park Place, you're more walking to some hotels. Pretty much sooner or later, the other person's going to go bankrupt. Okay? And then the inevitable get out of jail free card comes up. I mean, I'll enjoy getting the get out of jail free card, absolutely. Well, back in the Nehemiah's time, if you had a letter from the king, it was basically having a super TSA approved passport. You could go anywhere you want. Because if anything came up, you could just say, you messed me, you messed the king. And kind of the same way for us to live our lives too, that we've been given letters by God. We've been given a great book that says, just follow this, and when you come up with problems, just go back to the papers. So Nehemiah had safe travel, he had the ability to go to the royal park where all the timber was, and had that blank, open check. The king had so much faith in that to say, go and rebuild this wall. I want it to happen. So as they do that, we pick up in chapter 3, verse 1, the first thing, I know that when I start a project, I make my list out, right? We go lumber, nails, super glue, duct tape, and after that, it really doesn't matter much, because you got super glue and you got duct tape. Well, Nehemiah says in the scripture, in the third chapter, verse 1, that the first thing they did was they dedicated the process. Before they started, they prayed. Now think about our lives for a second. If the first time that we come up with a problem, we just stop everything and we just pray, would things be a little bit better? I think so. And we see that both times, in the first one, Nehemiah was asked by the king, what can make this work? And then the second time, when they were before they were to start the project, two times, what did he do before doing anything else? He prayed. It's a pattern of the way he lived. God, as we continue with the story, as things were happening, as they were building things, there became a crowd that was against them. Anyone ever been under construction and protected themselves at the same time? I had one time. It's kind of a unique story. We were doing a Habitat for Humanity project with our middle school kids. And we were up on the roof doing some shingling. And there was a police officer that was with us as our Habitat spokesperson. And a couple blocks over, we heard what was uniquely sounded gunfire. Want to get your attention real quick? Here's some gunfire real quick. So we get him off the ladder. He tells all the kids to go inside the house that we're fixing up. He gets on the radio, radios it in. He grabs his shotgun from the police car and says, guard my car in case anything happens. I looked at him. Guard your car with what? He goes, are you going to give me something? No. Well, I'm trying to get the scripture, did anyone take something? Okay? And he goes, yeah, let's forget that I kind of ever said that. So he went, the police showed up, and there was within minutes, we had cars protecting us, and it ended up just being some crazy stuff that happened. We had a couple of us that were no real problem. But even in that in the day, in Nehemiah, they all plotted together to come up and fight against Jerusalem and stir up trouble against it. But we prayed to our God and posted a guard day and night. To meet the threat. That the first time that as they came against tension, again, what was the first thing they did? They prayed. And then they had the common sense also to keep an eye on it. For God just doesn't want us just to pray, but to use our common sense and to be where He wants us to be. And there's going to be lots of obstacles sometimes in our lives. That sometimes when we think we're going to run out of something, that'll provide another way. There's a great new restaurant in the Orlando area called Four Rivers Barbecue. I don't know if anyone's ever heard of it. If you haven't, anyone ever been to it? I'm right, it's not bad, right? It's a great store. This Christian man was in the medical world doing some medical sales and stuff and thought God called him to start a restaurant. So he did what everybody else would do. Bought a building, hired a contractor, started building this barbecue restaurant. Got about a year or so into the project, and he ran out of money. And he had the opportunity, he said, I guess maybe that's not God's call, but he kept praying, and two or three days later, he was at the restaurant kind of cleaning some things up, and this gentleman walked in and said, I'm going to tell you something really crazy. And he goes, okay. He goes, I'm a Christian, and I feel God called me to help you finish this restaurant. And he goes, well, how did you even know that I was here? Saw a car in the parking lot. And God delivered him the person who he needed at that time to help him in that situation. And I can tell you the Four Rivers Barbecue is great. And they've opened up a couple more in Orlando and Florida. They opened one up about a mile or two from a friend of mine's house. Every time we go to lunch, he goes, where do you want to have lunch, Mike? Do you really need it? We had lunch six times the last year together. Do you really need to ask that question? And he said, are you driving down here to see me or just to have Four Rivers Barbecue? Whatever helps you sleep tonight. project, and we don't know what we're going to do because we have to feed our families. So Nehemiah says, I'll take care of it. Because when God puts you in a project and gives you abilities to finish the project, to finish the build which you're on, to provide the means.
Amen.
So Nehemiah goes to the officials in the government and says, hey, y'all can't be taxing these people anymore. They're working on God's project. And you know what? The miracle happened. They went, okay. Can you imagine rolling to Washington right now? Say, we got some better uses for our money than you right now, so just go ahead and give it back to us. Just can't imagine how that would really go. He even got the people who were loaning people money to forgive the debts. How great would it be to walk into Wells Fargo, Bank of America, and go, I don't think I should have to pay for this anymore because I'm working on God's project. And they would go, okay. But yet, sometimes it just takes following God and seeing where he's calling us to go in order to get to that spot. At the end, they finished the wall in 52 days. Can you imagine a kilometer wall finished in 52 days? I know that in our church back home, we were supposed to be into our new building January 1st last year. We got in for the first time on the first day of school in August. That's how delayed our project got. So I can't imagine building a kilometer wall in 52 days, let alone, you know, in a year. Obviously, they didn't have permits back in the day. They didn't have people inspecting back in the day, so maybe that made it a little bit easier. But God put the timing on their lives to where he needed it to be. And they were simply obedient and faithful to what God was going to do. So kind of after the project, there's only one thing to do after a project. You finish your life, celebrate. How many of us celebrated last night? A little bit? Okay? There are probably some people who know if you're, you know, a fan of certain schools, like Ohio State, you probably didn't celebrate. Sorry to bring that up. And Penn State didn't play until Monday, so I've got a couple more days to be happy. I'm going to tell you what's going to happen. USC's pretty good. Well, we got to celebrate yesterday. In the Whitehall family, we have a deep tradition of celebrating English style 6 hours ahead of time. Because I can't make midnight anymore. I was thankful that the service today was 10 o'clock and not 9 o'clock. I'll be honest, that was a help. My kids were both up at 4:30 though. I don't know why, but that's what it was. But here's how they celebrated the project back in the day. So on the first day of the seventh month, Ezra the priest brought the law before the assembly, which was made up of men and women, and all who were able to understand. He read it aloud from daybreak till noon, as he faced the square before the water gate, in the presence of men, women, and others who could understand. And all the people listened attentively to the book of the law. And God's desire, as we celebrate, is to just read Scripture. To know that no matter where we go, no matter what we have going on in our lives, that the best way to celebrate is simply be with Jesus. That as things get more complicated, it's just a call back to going back for God. So that read from the book of law, of God making it clear and giving the meaning so the people understood what was being read. That Nehemiah, the governor, Ezra the priest, and the teacher of the law, and the Levites who were instructing the people, said to them all, this day is holy to the Lord your God. Do not mourn or weep. All the people had been weeping as they listened to the word of God. Go and enjoy choice food and sweet drinks, and send some to those who have nothing prepared. This day is holy to our Lord. Do not grieve, for the joy of the Lord is your strength. To think about this, so simply that in our lives, God's desire for us is to read Scripture, to be happy, and to have that joy that only he can provide. God's desire for us is to eat the best, to live the best, but we can only do that as we follow the things that God gives us. I'm going to close with this scripture today, Romans chapter 12, verses 1 and 2. It says, therefore, I urge you, brothers and sisters, in view of God's mercy, to offer your bodies as living sacrifices, holy and pleasing to God. This is your true and proper worship. Do not conform to the pattern of this world, but be transformed by the renewing of your mind. Then you will be able to test and approve what God's will is, his good, pleasing, and perfect will. Because as we all make resolutions, or I like to call them plans, it's short to spell, that my plan for this year is a simple one. It's just simply to love God more than I did yesterday. I've prayed that a lot of times when we're together. That it doesn't have to be that complicated. It doesn't have to be super grand or have 23 different steps. My encouragement to you this year is to help keep it simple. To say, Lord, I just want to love you and be obedient to your word. And to know that as we do that, we'll be blessed beyond all measure. We pray for this. Lord, it can be that simple. That as we gather, not just to worship here, but in our own homes, to worship as a family, help us to be like Nehemiah, that in every situation, pray first, seek you out, and to know that as we honor you with the way that we live, that your love will always be there for us. There's no project too big for us, because you, the Creator, are the one who gives us strength and energy and resources for what you've called us to do. Thank you for the ability to share this message. It's in Jesus' name that we pray. Amen.
Amen.
As we continue our time of service for church this morning, this prayer time, I don't think there's a better way to start the year than to pray together. And I'm going to find my pencil that I took. I'll find another one. But if anyone has a prayer request, raise your hand, let me know. We'll write it down. We'll put it on the prayer list. And that'd be good. We'll pray together. Anybody have some?
Thank you.
different spots. Lord, we know that even in the hard times that we face, you are still God. You are still our King. You're still our Creator. Even though we go through struggles, or have friends that go through struggles, we trust in you to know that you'll never put anything on us that we can't handle. We have friends that are going through battle, cancer, and other disease, and lift them up to you. So ask the Lord that you heal them, give them comfort, give them peace. There's some of us out there struggling with jobs. Maybe we're wrestling with where the next paycheck's going to come or what the next opportunity could be. Again, we simply give it to you. To know that as we give it to you, we're not supposed to worry or fret. To continue to pray and seek you out. For there is where our true answers will always, always be. Lord, we also know that there's some of us struggling with things that we don't want to mention out loud. As we simply take a moment of silence, we pray to you, to our Heavenly Father, knowing that you touch our hearts as only you can.
Thank you.
September. If y'all need anything, we'll make a drive. I'm really enjoying my family's having a great time. My boys would normally be here, but their bellies are sick, so we didn't want to contaminate the whole Kirk. So they're locked back in the office, but they've enjoyed coming down and being part of us. You are our official vacation church, so thank you for allowing me to help out the last couple weeks. Let's pray together. Lord, as we end this day, right now in the service, our faith in you does not end. For you called us to take the light, the great news of Jesus, everywhere we go. Help us to do that when it's hard. Help us to do that when it's easy. To not rely on our own power and understanding, but to seek you out. And to know that it's going to be good enough. Touch our hearts as only you can. And our prayer is simple. That we love you more today than we did yesterday. And help us share that love with the people around us. It's in Jesus' name that we pray. Amen.
Amen. Thank you for the time here today. We know people are wondering.